Rohan Corday is research analyst with Prabhudas Leeladhar. He's joining us right now. Rohan, thanks very much for your time. What should be the most critical things to watch out of the Bajaj results?
I think for Bajaj, what we need to watch out is the operating margin that they record. My expectation is 28.8% for the quarter. If they're able to beat that, then that should be taken positively.
28% plus should be good.
20.8%.
20. Okay. 28 would be great, wouldn't it? All right. So, in terms of volumes, etc., when we get the monthly volume numbers, we saw what has happened with Hero. Any thoughts there? Top line, essentially?
Well, Bajaj's monthly volumes were relatively better than Hero's. They were flattish while Hero's had gone down 7% in the quarter. Now, some of the factors which Hero benefited from, which is a lower commodity cost, will also be applicable for Bajaj. So, that should be a positive for them. Also, Bajaj, on a quarter-on-quarter basis, has a higher share of exports in the mix. So, that should also help their EBITDA margin as far as QOQ improvement is concerned. So, all those things will be looked at, and whether they are able to record gains comparable to Hero or whether they are able to meet expectations for the quarter, that is something that we'll be watching out for.
On the export side, where Bajaj has had a bit of trouble, I think last quarter, the beginning of the year basically, and then is now back in full steam. Are realizations expected to be better? Is that a large variable?
Realizations are not expected to be significantly better because they do hedge their exports in a band. But going forward into the fourth quarter and 517, the slight depreciation in the rupee that we have seen should be helping them in terms of improvement in realization on exports.
So that is only in third and fourth quarter?
Yeah.
Is hedged? All of it is hedged, is it? Receivables?
No, they keep part of it open, but large proportion of it is hedged.
Yeah, and why are you saying this should third and fourth quarter should show the benefit?
So they take their export hedging in a band. So according to me, as we move forward into the year, they start taking exposure for subsequent quarters as well. So this exposure for second quarter should have been taken before the rupee depreciation happened. So that's why I expect the benefits to come in subsequent quarters and not in the second quarter.
Right. On the scooter side, do you expect to hear anything?
Well, so far they have not announced anything. So, it's wait and watch. As of now, we are looking forward to the launch of the RE60 rather than the scooter, because the RE60 things are falling into place. So that is something that we are watching more keenly. Scooters, whenever the management takes a decision to launch, I guess it's only then that we can see start projecting any volumes from there. But since at this point of time the management has not guided for any scooter product, we are not factoring anything.
Right. It's an old issue. So if you look at the industry volumes now, it's very clear, right? I mean, the market is shifting towards scooters rather than motorcycles.
Yes, there are certain scooter products which have done really well, and particularly from TVS and Honda. We also have Hero launching a couple of new scooters. But for Bajaj, so far, whatever recovery we have seen in the last two quarters in their volumes, they have been able to regain part of the lost market share by launching the entry-level bikes. So, even in the motorcycles, while the entire segment is shrunk in this financial year, and even in the past few years where the scooters have been capturing market share, Bajaj, so far with its focus on premium bikes and then the entry-level bikes in this year, have been able to recoup some of the lost market share.
Okay. When I've kind of spoken to this entire Mr. Bajaj on the scooter issue, his explanation has been simple. He said the scooter market is much larger, so you know, a 20% share there as against a 50% share in scooters makes more sense. Because the volumes, the units are the vast difference between both segments. How would you, as an analyst, if there's an announcement at the future date that Bajaj is coming back into scooters, how would you take it?
Well, so far, if we look at the scooter space, then you really need to have a good product which will take on the industry leaders for any new model to make a difference. So any announcement will be looked at quite closely in terms of what model is being offered and with whom is it competing, and eventually on the ground whether it can make a difference. So essentially, if you're looking at taking on the Activa, which is so far been the runaway leader in the scooter space, then it is not likely that in the near term you'll be able to make a difference. It will need a good performance to be shown by the product over a longer term for them to actually make an impact in the scooter space. And I mean, I don't think in the near term any of the competitors are in a position to challenge Activa as seriously. It will be only over the long haul where anyone can be able to make a difference.
Okay, fair enough. Let's just move away from Bajaj. We'll talk about the numbers when they come out, and hopefully we'll be able to get a reaction from you once we have the numbers. Just some thoughts on Maruti, and what do you think is your thought process on that one? I mean, one of the first names to make a new 52-week high, then sold off back to about 4150, 4200, now coming back a little bit. There's the Baleno, which is being launched. What's your view on Maruti?
I'm positive on Maruti. I have a buy rating. My target price is 4712, so it is inching closer to that target price once again. I think this quarter should also be good for Maruti. The EBITDA margin expansion is expected to be quite robust on a YOY basis, and expecting healthy growth in profits as well. So with 9.8% volume growth for the quarter and doing better than the industry, I think the Maruti story remains intact for the next few quarters.
Okay. All right, fair enough. When are numbers, by the way, from Maruti?
Maruti is next week.
Mahindra, what is your view there? Is there any feedback on the new launches? TUV 300, yeah.
The first month has been decent, but then they are involved in dispatches that you're doing to the national dealer level. So we'll need to track the performance over 3 to 4 months to see how the actual customer response has been. I have an accumulated rating on Mahindra at this point of time. I think tractors are at the bottom, but I don't see any immediate recovery coming in for the tractor industry. So we'll probably need to wait until April before we actually start seeing some traction on the tractor segment.
Yeah, I mean, UVs have been in a pretty tough spot. I mean, as an industry, and Mahindra in particular, and tractors are also no real hope of any recovery. What's the play here? Why would you hold on? I mean, is it possible the stock derates from here?
I think the stock has stagnated for the past 1 year or so because both of its segments were weak. As I said, tractors are at the bottom. So structurally, we should start seeing tractors improve in FY17. If the rainfall is adequate, then the growth rate will be higher than what we are estimating at this point of time. So we need to be patient with M&M. I think it has always performed well for long-term investors, and that story should continue to pan out even going forward from here with the UV launches. The M&M is trying to regain the lost market share overall, and the new launches in the UV one segment should also help make it an impact. So I think it's one to look forward to in FY17. I don't see a near-term recovery in tractors, and that's the only reason why I say it's a very good long-term bet.
All right, got that. Thank you very much. Good speaking with you, Rohan. Appreciate you joining us, and hope you join us once the Bajaj numbers today are out pretty soon. Thanks indeed.